Hi guys, and welcome to the Build From Hell part 2. Yes, I'm building another one of the same machines. Just got to try and get this sorted here. It's there. Right, Build From Hell part 2. Basically, we're making another one of the same machine. And now that I actually know what I'm up against, I'm a bit cooler of temper, shall we say. The first thing from this particular angle is that the hard drive is in there, right at the back. I don't know if you can see it. Well, put it this way, after mounting everything in this one, I got the second set. I got another SSD and I took what was left of the screws and things. And I tell you, I could have done with RPK vids being here because that's one puzzle I could not solve. So what I had to do was get some washers and just put the standard screws in the washers, then it was able to grab onto the case with no problem. The DVD-ROM here is mounted. They've got this very nice locking mechanism here and holds it quite well. Impressed with that. On the outside, as well as not having a reset switch, it's also got no hard drive activity LED, which, but there you go. One of the things which I've traditionally been a bit bad at explaining, but I'm going to have a bit of a go now, so forgive me if I just make a complete hash of this, is power supplies. Now, why I'm going to have a go at it now is because if I stuff this up, Specsbean Farmer sent me a link to a video which will probably do a better job of it than I can. There will also be another link to it's Linus's Tech Tips. There will be another link to a much earlier one which talks about fans in cases, airflow, and another one which I think was earlier still that caught my eye because it discussed silent builds. The long story short with fans in the case is that you hit a certain level and then it's a point of diminishing returns, but it's a video worth watching just to see the numbers at the end of it. One of the other videos that Specs forwarded was power. Now, I use one of these. This is a green lamp power watcher, and I will, it's dead now, I think the capacitor's gone, but I will use this to watch the power usage of my machines over a period of time, and I will build up a profile. Ultimately, I suppose that you could say that the best thing to do is build your rig and then monitor it for a while and then buy your power supply. But there we go. I already had the A10 running in another board, and this is basically what I got. The first thing that you'll notice when you look at power supplies ratings and all these power efficiency charts is that they mess around. Some of them mess around with the axes. I mean, whenever you're looking at a graph from anyone, be it a politician, anything, a lot of them tend to mess around with the sides. They compress them and they chop it off, you know, to make the curve look more dramatic. So it's one thing that whenever you look at a graph, keep that in mind and to have a look at the axes to see what they've done. Now this is these are the efficiency points that Be Quiet gave for this power supply that's in here now. 20%, it's 87.4 efficient. 50%, 89.2. 100%, 86.9. And this is a graph which I basically used. You can see 100% up there. And you know, looking at it, in the great scheme of things, the curve isn't that bad, to be perfectly honest. Peak is obviously appears to be at about 50%. That tail end I sort of extrapolated from the curve. And these are my usual points that came off the wattage meter. Regular R is about 35 to 40 watts. D is when I'm watching a DVD. H is when I'm watching high def, and G is when I'm playing a game. That's when it gets up to about 100, 120 watts-ish area. So I plotted those and took a look. Now, one of the things that you'll find out from the Linus's Tech Tip videos is that the efficiency rating of the power supplies goes up at as the overall power of the power supplies go up. So in order to get a like a silver efficiency, I'd have to get a more powerful power supply. Even though one of the things that they prove is that just going for a larger power supply doesn't mean that it's going to chew more power. But if you go up a power supply, let's say I went up to about, just trying to hold this in a way that you can see it and I can demonstrate. If I went up to, say, something like a 500 watt power supply, which would be over here somewhere, there, okay, the center point may be a bit better, but you'd still be dealing with a curve. So it'd still probably be intersecting at roughly the same places. I'm obviously exaggerating this, but because I'd still just be pulling the same kind of power. The other thing is when I compared them against the other low power machines that I was running, and it turned out that the A10 was pretty much as ish efficient as the lower power processors. The only difference was if I wanted to ask more of the lower power processors, they weren't able to give it because they didn't have the power. But leaving this rig running over the day, you know, if it's only chewing 35 to 40 watts, I can live with that. And that's 35 to 40 watts measured after the power supply, between the power supply and the wall. So that's including the whatever I'm losing in transforming as well. So here we go. Pretty much typically I've got the mount points in, so I'm just going to fit the motherboard as before, now that everything's fitted, and see you in a moment. Okay, now we're going to take a bit of a closer look at the motherboard and the mounting. Now obviously these ridges mean that it's going to have to go that side down, but there's a number of things that interfere. One of the things is these chips here, those chips there, and there's a few pins down here. The net result is that these two wings are going to have to be taken off, and there's still going to be a bit of interference with those chips, so I'm going to have to dig into an area here, and these chips are going to cause me to have to slice out an area here. So after I've taken that out, eased that off, chopped these wings off, then we'll be able to mount. Ah, whoever said this was easy. Ugh. Okay, the heatsink backplate is now cut and filed. Very important that it's filed. You don't want any sharp edges potentially cutting into the tracks. And boy, did I get it from you guys about the amount of paste I used. You'll be happy to know that I did go back over the other machine and redo the paste. Ego Shredder was very kind and in the comments section of the previous video put a couple of links to articles on processor paste. I mean, what would I know about it? The first time I was handling processors was in the day of the 8086. I don't think processor paste came on until the Pentiums, and even then they were more mounted on daughter boards with heat sinks already fitted, so yeah. But that's my excuse, and I'm sticking to it, guys. But one of the things that Ego Shredder put in the articles, there was some testing done with various configurations. This is the cross and dot configuration that apparently Cisco recommends, so I'm going with that. Now it's just going to be a case of fitting the heatsink, the fan, and getting the motherboard mounted and ready to rock and roll. So among the other things, I'm going to also fit, you didn't see me fit the wireless, the Wi-Fi connectors in the previous one, which is those. I did fit them in the end. I mean, what the heck? I mean, they fit to this board down here, if you can see it. And it's a case of what the heck, I might as well put them in. I mean, who knows when I'm going to use Wi-Fi on this kind of motherboard. Yes, so I'm going to get this all fitted up, screwed in, and yeah. See you yet again in a few minutes, which for you will be probably instantaneous. The Build from Hell version 2 finale. plugged it in, switched it on, nothing. Narrowed it down to either the processor or the motherboard, and that's the one problem when you're doing stuff at home. You typically don't have spares to hand in order to prove quickly what's wrong. So I've had to put the seller of both the processor and the motherboard on notice. And I've ordered another processor because that's the cheapest. I'll find out in due course, but pretty much that's all that you guys need to know for the moment. This is the way that it goes. Don't know what's going to happen now. I'm going to have an argument with somebody. See you later, folks. Bye for now.